What makes a good club? It's kind of a profound thought for a moment. You all had those thoughts in your mind when you joined us or looked at us or investigated us. Is it the purpose of the club? The personality of the members? Is it the way we structure our meetings? Or perhaps it's the atmosphere that we create individually and collectively as club members? What I'd like to do is share with you today what makes us a successful club. What makes any club successful within Toastmasters? There are elements you may not think often about, but certainly the building blocks are what makes every one of us willing to be here and enjoy coming back week after week. Atmosphere is not the weather. It's what we experience every day. It's the environment we live in. In a club, the atmosphere is our operations. It's our members. It's our attitudes. And most importantly, our willingness to become transition from guests to members. What I'd like to talk about briefly today is setting of the good example, how we welcome our guests and nurture them, and also showing our seasoned members that we care for them and want their success. Start off with the examples. Setting the good example. Our club officers set good examples by, first of all, volunteering and doing what they do for us every day. Our sergeant at arms sets up the meeting room every day for us, makes sure that it's well lit, it's neat, it's organized properly. He's got a lot of work to do every day, but he is setting the good example by making sure our physical environment has been created in which we can conduct a smooth and even meeting. More of the physical environments is the placement of our ribbons up on the flag. We want to tout our successes, and they are many. Menti, that's a new word. We have a guest book out in the lobby area, and when our guests come in, they want to sign that guest book. We want to encourage them to do that. We want to give them a name tag and help usher them into the environment so we get to meet them and know them a little bit. Well, what can you do to make that good impression and set that example? First of all, get here on time. Getting here 5 minutes ahead of time does not quite match up with what we need to do, because there's a lot of last-minute things that have to be attended to. So make sure you get here about 15 minutes ahead of time, and you'll see why that's important as we go on. Be prepared. Bring your CL manual. Bring your competent leadership book. Bring your agenda if you're the Toastmaster, because we want to get those things filled out along the way. Also, if you're a speaker and you have some props or some visual aids, test them out ahead of time. Get here ahead of time so you can make sure the projector's operating, the lights are right, the whiteboard is cleared off and making way for your scribbles that you're going to write up there that are barely legible. Wear your name badge. When we're talking to you, we'd like to know who you are. And we all know which shoulder that goes on when we paste it up there, right? Our right-hand shoulder. Offer to help. If you get here ahead of time, you can offer to help. A lot of times, people can't get here on time, they fall, changes happen. What do we do to compensate for that? Well, you need to step up. Let the Toastmaster know. Listen, I've got a hip pocket speech here, so if our main speaker doesn't show up, I can step up and help with that. But listen, do you need a role like today? We did a little switching roles between Shorna as the timer, and I think Kim was taking a different role. Okay, there they are, side by side. So that cooperation is setting the example. When you do that together and silently, everybody knows it's going on. And our Toastmaster rightfully acknowledges that to you. Volunteer for committees and offices. Again, setting the example. We have lots of opportunities in Toastmasters there are the contests that we pull off, there are public relations programs that we generate. So make sure you step up and take part in those. That's setting the example again. Be supportive. During the meeting, when somebody walks up to the lectern, this is not supportive. This is supportive. Okay. But we have a mutual responsibility, too, as somebody coming up to the lectern, is to get ourselves positioned early on so we don't have to have a long-term round of applause, because the longer it lasts, the weaker it gets. During the meeting, or after the meeting, make sure you congratulate the speakers. Walk up and speak, talk to them. Tell them what you liked about their speech. Encourage them. It takes a little bit of encouragement for each one of us to aspire to bigger and better things. Compliment the Table Topics Master. We have some very creative Table Topics Masters in our midst, and especially the Table Topics speakers, how they can think well off the cuff. Every one of the participants, be they the evaluators, timers, grammarians, everybody does a hard job or a difficult job at times. And when they render a good service to us, we should let them know. Just take a little time to teach each one, tell each one how much their efforts are appreciated. Your personal touch is valuable. It has to come sincerely from the heart. As we move on with creating the right atmosphere, we have to attend to our guests. They're the lifeblood of our club. Don is one of our newest members, I believe.
Not yet.
Was about to become. So how do we nurture that? How do we take care of Don when he first came in here? Have you ever gone, you have been here the first time when you first walked in that door. Left you with a couple question marks. You walk in. Where do I go? What do I do? Who do I see? Why do I do it? All those questions are in your mind. It's our responsibility, primarily the Sergeant at Arms and our Vice President for Membership, to nurture that process out there as best we can. But individually, every member should step up to the bar. Engage that individual. Greet them warmly. Help them sign in. Maybe fill out their name tag for them. That's always nice. Introduce them to the officers as appropriate as you meet them, and also help them find a seat. It's always great to, as you set them down, introduce them to the people on both sides. Again, just little elements that help that person melt away their anxieties or inhibition about coming here for the first time. You want to talk with them. Why did you come here? What interests you about Toastmasters? Have you ever visited another club before? What is it you like to do that you think Toastmasters can offer you? When you ask those questions, you're asking questions about them, because it truly is all about them. It's not about you. So engage them, get them to talk and share with you, and then you'll get to learn more about them in a short period of time, and they will feel warm and wanted and appreciated. You also have to be prepared to answer some questions. And I think we all know how those questions come. Well, how long does the meeting last? How soon do I have to give my first speech? And you have to make that person feel comfortable about the answers you're going to give them. And you also want them to ask those questions. What are these two books for? Frankly, I don't know. I've been here a year and a half. I haven't gotten figured out myself. That's not the answer we're looking for. So pick up a book. Show them. Just nurture the process. Take the time. When you give of yourself, you'll get a lot back personally, and you'll also be nurturing that guest along the way. But especially at the end of the meeting, if you think things have gone well, even if you don't, invite them back. Those first impressions are important, but the second and third ones, I think, are what we at Speakeasy are stellar at making. Now we have to talk about our current members, our seasoned Toastmasters. Once you're a Toastmaster, and you've been in the club for a while, you kind of become a little chopped liver. And we have a lot of enthusiasm when people give their icebreakers and they give speech 1, 2, and 3, yada, yada. But when you're on speech number 47, 20, maybe that mutual enthusiasm wanes a little bit. Something to think about. Well, to create the right atmosphere, we all need mentors. So each one of us should be assigned a mentor when we first come on, and also engage that mentor as time goes on. A mentor is a coach. Mentors provide individualized assistance and advice. Be it personal, hopefully it's focused on the project that the person is doing. Make some time to get together with that person. A little bit of your time is worth a lot. Make yourself available, maybe by email, over the phone, or perhaps over a cup of coffee. As you are helping to nurture that person go through a project, they're learning from you, and you're taking away a little bit more from this. But more importantly, you're building a relationship, and you're helping to certify the reason that person is here. because they're very important things to do. Sign up for the support roles. All right, we want to make sure that we're doing all the different jobs around the clock as far as the table topics masters, the timers, the evaluators. And those roles are important for you as an individual to recognize the value they are to the club and the club's value back to you when you fill those positions. Paying attention to those continuing members, don't forget the core members at all. Whether a Toastmaster for a few months or many years, everyone deserves your attention and appreciation. Many of the reasons we came here was because we had the fear of public speaking. I remember a few weeks ago we had a young lady who says, "I'm free." And she danced the tango out here in front of us. But I also remember that same person the first day she was here. "I'm Kay. I don't want to talk to you." Another person who has kind of come out of her shell. I don't want to mention Shawna's name here in public, but Shawna has gone the whole gambit from, "Hi, I'd like to give a Toastmaster speech," to, "I can't wait to give my 45th one." But what does that say about these people? Each one of us is responsible for having helped to nurture that person by our enthusiasm, our support, our words, our suggestions. And that is very important. That is what makes Speaky successful. That is what makes each one of us a success. The seasoned members, make sure you engage them a little bit more than you do. Vaughn, what's your next project?
Competent leader.
Drew, do you have any interest in becoming a club officer? Interesting. We'd like to see that. Vivian, how have you been able to use some of the things you've learned at Toastmasters in your business as a realtor?
In my presentations. It's been very helpful.
Excellent. Those are little nuggets of information we need to ask, draw out, understand about our current members. It's silent. We don't always know about it, but take the time to ask. It doesn't hurt. It actually feels very good. And think of how well Vivian feels, or Drew feels, when you ask them those questions. It's critically important. Many of our members want to fill different roles, be they in their job. Maybe some of them want to aspire to be officers in the club. John is a starring example. I think when John walked in the door, he had officership in the back of his mind somewhere, and he has been a stellar leader at that helm for us. Be considerate. Dynamic speakers are stimulating speeches, and stimulating speeches are the hallmark of Toastmasters. Bryant was a guest here the other day. Did anybody go to the area conference and see Bryant speak down there a little bit as a Toastmaster that led the event? He's smooth, he's got humor, he's got poise, he has confidence. And those are the elements that we need to bring into our presentations as we give them, and I've seen that around the room. We do that by being, we nurture that process by being considerate. There are some pitfalls. You have to be able to get up here and be prepared. And also, you have to give sufficient time, if there are any changes that have to be made, to make sure the Toastmaster knows what's going on. Evaluations. We owe the most superior evaluations to our members that we could possibly give them. We need to have our seasoned evaluators evaluate our seasoned speakers. And it's a process that you go through. After you get three or four evaluations under your belt, you see what needs to be done and how it has to be done. Evaluations are important if they are focused on the objectives. And they should also be focused on the individual's learning needs. Two primary criteria. Poor evaluations come in two forms. Whitewash, which always begs the question after a whitewashed evaluation, where's the beef? All the fluffy words were there, we heard it, but did the person receiving the evaluation really get any meat for it, any value for that? That's kind of a disservice to the individual. And there's the tough love evaluations. Kind of scared people. Like, oh man, this is my icebreaker. And they were cruel, I don't want to do this again. You have to strike the happy medium. Speakers expect to learn from their presentations, so your evaluation should be objective-based, have specifics for improvement, be truthful, sincere, and well-structured. We should recognize achievements. Compliments, again, are a strong motivator. When people achieve their different pins and awards, make sure that we recognize that. Finally, friendship and fellowship among our members is critical to our success. Camaraderie, in a word. It enhances performance and increases retention of our club members. Each one of these different factors are important to establish and maintain our healthy club atmosphere. Setting a good example, taking care of our guests, and nurturing our new members, our current members. So if you can follow these simple guidelines, it will nurture us individually and collectively. I ask you to speak easy and speak often.